Thank you. I'm really excited to get the opportunity to speak here today and to share some of the research findings that we have ongoing in our lab at the Sansom Institute and the Body and Mind Center at the University of South Australia. So I'm going to talk to you today about osteoarthritis in the brain. And as it was mentioned, osteoarthritis is common, and it's a joint degenerative joint disease that often affects people as they age. And things like bony changes, changes to the cartilage occur, and these progress, and it often becomes very painful, and people often have a feeling of severe stiffness in that joint. And then this, because of the pain, it almost, and quite often, gets to the point that surgeries like joint replacements have to be looked at as an option to control that pain. Now, the idea that osteoarthritis is so common, it would make us think that we would be very good at treating it. But we aren't. And so one of the things that I want to look at is this idea that maybe we don't have the whole picture here. And so right now, how we view osteoarthritis is primarily as a problem to do with the joint. But based on what you've heard Lorimer speak about today, and some of the things I'm going to share with you, I really want to question that. And I want to raise this idea that maybe it's actually time we need to think outside the joint when we look at osteoarthritis. So I'm going to start by showing you, these are two x-rays of two different people's knees who have osteoarthritis. Now, the one that you can see on your right-hand side, you'll see the bones of the leg there, indicated by white, and there's a nice big black space between those joints. That's good. When we see things like that, we're usually pretty happy as clinicians. But in this case, if I looked at it, I'd think, oh gosh, they must have very mild osteoarthritis. The one on your left, on the other hand, gosh, that doesn't look too good at all. A bit dire, doesn't it? It appears that there's bone on bone. Man, that must hurt so badly. What a severe case of osteoarthritis. But these patients come into the clinic, and they both report a pain of 5 out of 10. So what this suggests is that the amount of structural damage alone doesn't predict how much pain someone will experience. And it raises this possibility that other things are contributing to that process, contributing to that experience of pain. And this is where we think the brain might contribute. Now, Lorimer did a very thorough and I think a really good job of going through what happens when something occurs, such as a noxious stimulus, something that activates those nociceptors. In this case, the person is about to step on a thumbtack, something that I reckon would be a bit painful. But those nociceptors, the message sends up to the spinal cord. Then it goes up to the brain, through the spinal cord up to the brain. And when it gets there, as Lorimer mentioned, it has to evaluate that message of danger or threat. It is not a message of pain. So the brain has to make that evaluation. And we think that it does this by answering some different questions, such as, is this stimulus dangerous or is it going to damage my body? Is there anything I actually need to do about it? And where is this stimulus occurring? And this last question is something that's pretty new. We haven't considered this as much anymore, because of course we know where it's occurring. A snake bit him on the side of the foot. Of course we know where it's occurring. But what we're starting to find is that it might not be as straightforward as that, and this might play a very important role. And so based on the idea of and what the brain has decided of once it's evaluated that signal, it can either decide, gosh, we better pay attention to this, give me all the information that you can, and it can facilitate the information that comes up the spinal cord. Or it can decide, this has happened to me before, it was completely fine last time, let's not worry about it, and it can inhibit some of that information coming up. So that idea that this brain has control over the information that comes up is a really key concept. So it's important to think about how do we localize the body part. If we potentially think that our ability to know where that body part is important to pain, we do need to understand how we localize it. So we know that in our brain, there's an area called the primary somatosensory cortex, but what it does is it has a map of our whole body surface. So it's like a little virtual body, the little man in our brain. And what this does is it helps us know where we're being touched. So if someone touches you on the skin, the certain part of this map will activate, and that's how we know where we're being touched. But that's not enough information. We always have to know where our body is in space. And so then we also have to consider this. We also use information, of course, from vision. That will help us know where our body part is. And also, what motor actions are we doing? What movement did we do right before we were asked to identify where our body part is? And last, vestibular function, so where our head is in relation to our body. And the reason I show all of this is to show that it's actually quite a complex process to know where a body part is. All this different information has to come together, and we make a final decision of where we think our body is. So now I'm going to show you an illusion. Now, I don't know if you see this, but when I look at this, it appears as if those inner parts of the circle are almost spinning. And you can almost get a disconcerting feeling, and some people actually have even reported it feeling nauseous to them. So please raise some hands if anyone's feeling a bit sick, and I'll advance the slide. But with this, I show you this. Oh, someone is, put their hand up, let's switch on. I show you this because that picture wasn't moving. It was a static image. But our brain takes that information that's coming in and perceives it as rotating. And I think that's really interesting because I don't know about you, but I always think of this idea that what I experience, absolute truth. It's not. It is not. It is our perception of the information that's coming in, our brain's perception. And this is a similar one where if you kind of look, it's as if those little white dots in between the squares appear to turn black. I find this one quite interesting. But we use illusions in science so that we can understand more about how the brain perceives things. And that's a really interesting science in itself. But what I'm more interested in is, can we use illusions to alter people's perception? And that's important because people with chronic pain have altered perceptions of their painful body part. You may have experienced this yourself. If you've ever gone to the dentist and had part of your mouth frozen, you get that big, fat-feeling lip, feels like it's kind of drooping to the side. That's an altered perception. So we know in a condition that's called complex regional pain syndrome, and this is a condition that sometimes occurs after an event such as a limb fracture, we know that this condition, these people, have an altered perception of their body part. So these are some quotes from people who have CRPS. And what we see is that there is a real difference between what is real and what they feel. So this is a quote that says, and this lady's talking about her leg, "I feel like it's really, really fat. I mean, sometimes I look at it because I think, God, my leg's swollen. But then I actually look at my leg and I think, oh no, but it just feels like it is." So that person knows the leg isn't swollen, but it feels like it is. They perceive it to be swollen. And the same lady quote, shows that actually they may have a distorted mental image of that body part. So when asked to close her eyes and visualize what she saw of her leg, this is what she said. So she said, "It's bigger than this leg, and then the rest is completely void. I actually can see the floor. I see a big toe, and then I can't see anything from the knee down." So in this case, it's almost as if she's lost that body part. Now, altered perception, perhaps this is just specific to this relatively rare condition, but it isn't. If we look at people with back pain, what you'll find is this altered perception also occurs. So if we give them a picture of a back, and you can see the actual part of their back is missing, and you ask them to draw on that picture where they feel like their back is, where they perceive the edges of their trunk to be. Let's say they had pain on this side, on one side of their back. They're pretty good at drawing the other side. But if they have to draw the area of the back, they're often missing the area that's painful. They can't find their back. So we have this combination where people who have chronic pain often have this altered perceptions of their body. But what we do know is that in these same conditions, there's evidence that there's changes to the brain. So in that primary somatosensory cortex, that area of the brain that holds our body map, there is alterations to the painful body part, the area that represents the painful body part. And these changes that occur in the brain also relate to how much pain and how long they've had the pain. So we have this complex relationship between how they perceive their body part, what's going on in the brain, and how much pain they're experiencing. We also know that people with chronic pain aren't very good at localizing touch. So we use a measure, it's called two-point discrimination, where you touch someone on two points, and you slowly, slowly decrease the distance between those two points. And at some point, the person will only perceive being touched by one, despite you always touching them with two points. And this is thought to give us a representation of how good they are at knowing where they're being touched. And so they're not. But they're also not good at knowing where their body part is located. So this one, I don't know if you ever played the game when you were a little kid, where you had to put your arms out, you had to cross them, and you had to go like this. And someone would point at one of your fingers, not touch them, and you had to lift them up. And it's so hard. And the reason, obviously, there's a lot of conflicting information going on, but thinking about that game and how hard it is important, because in the past, we thought that the only reason they were bad at knowing where their body part was is because there was damage to the receptors that let them know that information of where it is. But at the time when we were kids, we were healthy, there was nothing wrong with any of our receptors, and we still found it difficult. So that actually suggests that the brain plays a very important role, independent of the receptors in your fingers or whatever body part, in knowing where that body part is. So we test this idea of is the brain the problem in knowing where the body part is by doing something called left-right judgments. So in this, we give people a picture of a body part, of a left or a right hand, for example. And what they have to do, without moving, is to decide whether it is indeed a left or a right hand. So I'll give you some examples of this. So I want you to respond, and you can yell out, you can say it in your head, do whatever you would like, as quickly but as accurately as you can. Left or right? Left or right? Left or right? Very good. Oh, gosh, you guys would do good on our tests. I'm shockingly bad. But these left-right judgments, the reason that we use them is that based on past studies, we know that when a person is making that judgment, what they're actually doing is mentally maneuvering that own body part to match the posturing of the body part in the picture. So in this way, we're evaluating their ability to know where something's located. Now, we're starting to see a growing body of evidence that these left-right judgments are disrupted in people with pain. So people with neck pain, if you give them pictures of neck and head rotation to the left or to the right, I just did that backwards, I don't know if any of you noticed that, they're poor at it. They're not very accurate at being able to discern between those two rotations. And the same goes for people with back pain. If you give them images of the trunk, I'm gonna try to get it correct this time, turning to the right or turning to the left, they're very poor at knowing which direction the trunk is turning. And last, people with chronic foot pain, if you give them images of feet, they're not very accurate at knowing whether it's a left or a right foot. So why on earth am I telling you all this? Well, we know that if we give treatments that are aimed at some of these changes, often pain reduces. So for example, if we get people to practice doing left-right judgments, if we get people to localize on that body part very sensitively where they're being touched, using some treatments like mirror box therapy, where the painful hand or body part is put on one side and the person sees the reflection of the good arm or good foot moving. Or doing some a little bit more advanced training, such as drawing letters on the hand or the painful body part. And of course, they're not looking, but they have to pick up the pattern. All of these things have been shown to reduce pain. So we're not giving any medications, we're not doing anything but reducing pain. Now, to bring this back to osteoarthritis, which is what I'm wanting to talk about, this idea that I showed before, that structural damage doesn't seem to relate to the amount of pain that people experience, and it brings up the idea that the brain might be involved. Well, people with osteoarthritis have those very same things going on that I've just talked about in other chronic pain conditions. So, for example, if we give them pictures of a hand, and some of the hands are larger and some of the hands are smaller, they will tend to choose a hand that is smaller than healthy controls, people without pain will choose, suggesting that they have this altered perception of their painful body part. We also know that touch is affected. Their ability to localize where they're being touched is affected. So using that same idea, that two-point discrimination test, it was tested in people with knee osteoarthritis, and it was found that at the knee, they had a significantly larger threshold, meaning they were much worse at localizing where they're being touched, as compared with people who had shoulder pain and as compared to healthy controls. So suggesting that, yeah, touch is affected, and that potentially that body map in the brain is actually affected in people who have osteoarthritis. So we also have found that the accuracy of those left-right judgments are affected in people with osteoarthritis. So this is the accuracy findings when we give them pictures of left feet and lower legs or right feet and lower legs. And what we found is that people who have osteoarthritis of the knee are significantly less accurate. They're only about 60% accurate at identifying these pictures as compared with healthy controls. And so this idea suggests not only are these maps that are related to touch affected in osteoarthritis, but so are some of these maps and areas of the brain that are related to how we know where our body part is. And this is one of the most interesting things and most compelling things, I think, about the role of the brain in osteoarthritis. We know that arthritic symptoms can exist without the limb being present. So this was a study where they looked at people who had rheumatoid arthritis on both sides, and for some reason had to have one of their legs amputated. And then they went on and developed a phantom limb, that feeling that the limb was still there. And what these researchers did was ask them about a feeling of stiffness. And what they found was that the participants still felt stiffness in that amputated limb, in the phantom limb. They felt stiffness in the joint that wasn't there. That's a huge indication that the brain is contributing to those symptoms. And what I found quite interesting to this as well is that when they did, we know that exercise, for example, can make the feeling of stiffness in osteoarthritis go away or relieve a little bit. When they did imagined exercise of the phantom limb, it removed stiffness. So, quite compelling evidence, I think. And then this is where I get really excited. So if we see all these alterations in how people perceive their body part, can we use illusions to alter their perception? And if we do, will that decrease pain? And that's the question I've been interested in investigating. And so what we use is this machine. It's called the Mirage. And basically, it's a box that involves some mirrors, it involves a camera, and it involves a computer. And a magician, that's sometimes what we like to call ourselves, and you'll see why in a moment. But what it does is it allows us to manipulate or alter real-time video. So a person puts their hands, for example, into the machine, and we can, in real time, change how that hand looks to them. So this is an example of what it looks like. So that's the person's hand. And what's very cool is, so when they put their hands in, well, you see that image visually elongate, we're actually giving a slight pull on the end of their finger. And that gives this really odd sensation that your finger is actually growing big and long. It's very odd. We also do an illusory shrink, where the visual image gets shorter, your finger shrinks, and we push on the end of your finger at the same time. Now, what's interesting with this is that this has been tested in people with hand osteoarthritis. And these illusions were found to immediately reduce pain by 25 to 35%, completely removed pain in 33% of people. And with some of these, if people tended to like one direction of an illusion versus another, so say they very much liked to have it stretched but didn't like shrink, the pain relief was up to 50%. So this is really intriguing that we're not doing anything to that joint itself, but we're seeing reductions in pain. And so while people were getting these illusions done, their perception of their body part was measured again, where we gave them pictures, and some of them were slightly longer, hand was slightly longer than normal, or slightly shorter. And the perception of their hand size completely normalized with this. So it was no different at all than to people who didn't have any pain in the hand. So it raises this possibility that maybe changing perception is really important. So some of the work that I'm doing is to adapt this system to people with knee osteoarthritis. And the reason I think that's important is because Australia has 80,000 joint replacements every single year. That's huge. And joint replacements, these surgeries come with risks. And we also know that joint replacements only last for so long. So if you have a 40-year-old who needs a knee joint, they may have three in their lifetime. So if we can prevent or delay the need for this, that's a really important thing. So what you're viewing here, and you'll see a better picture in the moment, but people come in, they put their leg into the machine, and it's just resting on a box. And what they then look down and see is the top of their knee joint. And that's their kneecap right here. And so this is what the illusion looks like. So you'll watch in a moment, and it will start to stretch. There you go. And then in a moment, it will start to shrink. And again, we're pushing and pulling at the exact right times. And there it starts to shrink. And we're evaluating whether this might be able to influence pain. And in our pilot work, we found that similar to the hand, there's about an immediate reduction of pain of 50% in people that we're doing these illusions on. So, of course, some of the questions that we're wondering are, how long does this pain reduction last? We don't know. And if we do it a bunch, if we train it a lot of days in a row, will the effect be better, or will it also last longer? And I think those are really important questions. So I think as a take-home message today, I really just want to say and reinforce this idea that your brain decides whether something is painful. And it seems that the disruptions to your brain's ability to know where your body part is located and to know what's going around in your body part, it is very important to the pain experience. And the pain in osteoarthritis appears to not only be about the joint. And that's a really big deal, actually, because until now, we've always considered that the only thing that can be contributing to that pain in osteoarthritis is problems with the joint. But I'm here to argue that it isn't. And based on that, what then becomes very exciting is that opens the door for new treatments. And whether it's a new treatment that's put on with another treatment or it stands alone, that's new options for people who have osteoarthritis. And I think that's a really, really important and really hopeful message. So I would like to say thank you to the research group that I work with, and as well as the funding sources that I have. And I'm going to have some blatant self-promotion here. If you're interested in participating, we need people who have knee osteoarthritis or hand osteoarthritis, as we're just starting to recruit. But we also need healthy controls. So if you're fit as a fiddle, we also want you. My email address is there. Email address of our research assistant, Helen Gilpin, is there, and my phone number. Thank you so much for your time, and I really appreciate your attention.